Hello, bonjour, Annie, and welcome to Health Sciences North LaBelle Innovation and Learning Center. We're so excited to have you here today and to welcome our special guest. So today we have with us the Right Honorable Justin Trudeau, the Prime Minister of Canada, Sudbury MP, the Honorable Viviane Lapointe, and Nickelback MP, the Honorable Marc Serré. As well, we have with us today our esteemed guest from Nawson University, Mr. Ray Hunt. Maybe just a little bit of a background around who Health Sciences North is. Health Sciences North is a regional academic health science center providing care to the population of northeastern Ontario, which numbers about 600,000 people. Our mission is to provide high-quality clinical care, to train the next generation of healthcare providers, and to conduct and engage in research that helps to improve the health outcomes of those living in northeastern Ontario. Today, you're standing in Health Sciences North LaBelle Innovation and Learning Center Simulation Lab. It is here that we are training the next generation of healthcare professionals. It is also here where our existing healthcare professionals get to come and learn new skills and to build their confidence and competence in the work that they do every day in serving the people that we serve here at Health Sciences North. We couldn't do this work without a strong collaborative relationship with Nawson University and our other academic partners that we work with here in northeastern Ontario. Our commitment as an organization is to work with federal government and all levels of government to build on the foundations of Canada's leading health system to help improve the health outcomes of those living in northeastern Ontario. I would now like to invite our MP from Nickelback, the Honorable Marc Serré, to come and say a few comments. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, David, and thank you everyone for being here. Just want to start off by thanking David and Health Sciences North, the staff here, and the work that you do day in, day out on the healthcare of our community. And it's great to be here with Ray from Nawson. As you all know, the partnership with Nawson and Health Sciences North, and Sudbury and Thunder Bay makes a huge difference all across Northern Ontario. And it's great to have our Prime Minister here, because this is a good example of a model of collaboration that is needed to help our all across Northern Ontario on the Indigenous side and French minority communities to make sure that we have the health professionals there. And it's great to be here with my colleague, a champion for Sudbury, MP Viviane Lapointe, and obviously that we'll be introducing our Prime Minister. But the announcement today is so important because we have a Prime Minister here that's been in Sudbury several times, been in Northern Ontario several times since being elected in 2015 to make a lot of good, solid announcements, make a difference. Not only here on the infrastructure side, but we've done a lot of research dollars for Health Sciences and Laurentian and a lot of the post-secondary institutions all across Northern Ontario. And more importantly, this is a Prime Minister that has worked really hard to make sure that we have agreements with provinces, with premiers that make a difference. And that's what people are asking us, all levels of government, to be working together. Alors, c'est un grand plaisir d'être ici aujourd'hui avec le Premier ministre et mon collègue Viviane Lapointe. Évidemment, on regarde ici une annonce historique, comment on peut aider la communauté du Nord-Ontario pour certains qu'ensemble, que le gouvernement fédéral, la province, les municipalités ici, pour faire certain qu'on délivre pour les gens du Nord-Ontario d'une façon substantielle pour la santé. Alors, c'était important. Merci beaucoup. Puis, je vais passer la parole à mon collègue, la championne de Sudbury, Viviane Lapointe. Merci.
Merci, Marc. Bonjour tout le monde. C'est un plaisir d'être parmi vous aujourd'hui. C'est un vrai plaisir d'avoir le premier ministre ici à Sudbury. I can tell you as MP for Sudbury, I have the opportunity to connect with many constituents all across Sudbury. And one of the things that they bring up a lot is healthcare. Their concerns for accessing healthcare, their concerns for accessing waitlist physicians, and the vital care that they need. And I can tell you that our federal government has listened, has heard you, and it is with great pleasure that I can now introduce the Right Honourable Prime Minister of Canada, Justin Trudeau, to tell you more about that. Merci.
Merci Viviane, merci pour tes paroles, mais surtout merci pour ton leadership et ton travail ici comme députée locale à Sudbury. C'est toujours un plaisir d'être de retour ici avec toi et d'entendre les préoccupations de tes commettants. Merci aussi Marc d'être ici. Tu représentes Nickel Belt depuis bon nombre d'années pour nous à la Chambre des communes et tu es toujours un travailleur acharné pour bien représenter tes commettants aussi. David, thank you very much for your welcome here to Health Sciences North. It's great to see this extraordinary facility that serves so many people across the region, and the cutting edge research and innovation and service that is offered here is truly remarkable. Ray Hunt, thank you so much as CEO the Northern Ontario School of Medicine. We see really, really important potential, not just to continue to do the extraordinary work that you're doing, but to grow it. I'll talk about that in a moment. I also want to recognize Paul Lefebvre, the mayor of Sudbury, a former colleague in the House of Commons. Merci, Paul, pour tout ce que tu fais pour bien servir la belle ville de Sudbury et bâtir un avenir plus fort pour tous. Avant de commencer, je veux souligner que depuis hier soir et ce matin, les Canadiens sont entourés de tribus, de souvenirs, de souvenirs et de récollections du service extraordinaire de l'ancien premier ministre Brian Mulroney. On a des pensées pour sa famille et ses amis, mais on est en train de voir à quel point c'était un homme remarquable qui a façonné le Canada d'aujourd'hui. Je peux confirmer aujourd'hui qu'évidemment, il y aura des funérailles d'État pour l'ancien premier ministre. On va partager des détails en temps et lieu, mais on est en train de travailler avec la famille pour s'assurer que tous leurs souhaits soient respectés. Mais je peux confirmer aussi qu'il va y avoir des opportunités pour les Canadiens d'exprimer leur gratitude et offrir leur hommage à l'ancien premier ministre et à sa famille. Before I begin, I want to highlight that last night and this morning, Canadians have been awash with reflections and memories and tributes to former Prime Minister Brian Mulroney. He marked the history of this country, the present of this country, and it is right that we all be reflecting on him and his family today and for many days to come. I can confirm that obviously there will be a full state funeral for the former Prime Minister. We're working with the family closely to ensure that all of their wishes are respected and that it be the right and fitting tribute to him. We will be sharing more details, of course, in coming moments. But I can also let everyone know that there will be opportunities for Canadians to express their gratitude and share tributes to the former Prime Minister as the coming days and weeks unfold. Les Canadiens sont très fiers de notre système de santé universel public. C'est une force pour ce pays. On sait que d'avoir l'assurance que si on tombe malade, on ne va pas devoir vendre notre maison ou prendre une nouvelle hypothèque ou devoir être pénalisé financièrement. C'est une grande force de notre pays. Canadians are rightly proud of our public health care system, and it's a strength for us that we know that if we fall ill, we're going to be there for each other to make sure that everyone gets the care they need, regardless of where they live or of how much they make. But we also have to be honest that our healthcare systems haven't been meeting the mark of what Canadians expect over the past years. That's why, as a government, we've committed $200 billion over the next 10 years to invest in healthcare systems across the provinces and territories, with $25 billion specifically for tailored agreements with the provinces going at particularly high priority areas. Ici en Ontario, c'est un accord de 3,1 milliards de dollars sur trois ans qu'on vient d'annoncer il y a quelques semaines, qui va couvrir des éléments essentiels pour les Canadiens. Tout d'abord, assurer un meilleur accès aux médecins de famille. On sait que les médecins de famille sont une entrée pour les gens vers le système de santé. On a besoin que plus de gens aient accès à des médecins de famille. On a besoin de raccourcir les délais. Les temps d'attente sont trop longs pour des soins de santé, donc on va raccourcir ces délais. On est aussi en train de travailler avec les provinces pour embaucher plus de travailleurs de la santé. On a besoin de plus de personnel, ceux qui travaillent dans notre système, particulièrement depuis la pandémie, travaillent beaucoup, beaucoup plus fort et ont besoin de renforcement, et c'est exactement ce sur quoi on est en train de travailler. On reconnaît aussi le besoin d'avoir de meilleurs accès aux soins de santé mentale. C'est une grande priorité, particulièrement pour nos jeunes, et d'assurer avec ces accords avec les provinces qu'il va y avoir une emphase mise sur les soins de santé mentale. Fait partie de ce à quoi on s'attend. Et aussi, il y a des investissements pour s'assurer que les peuples autochtones reçoivent une meilleure qualité de services et de soins, ce qui est important à travers le pays, mais particulièrement dans les régions comme le nord de l'Ontario, où il y a énormément de communautés autochtones. Tous ces enjeux-là et ces engagements qu'on est en train de signer avec les provinces sont ancrés dans une meilleure collecte de données. We know that as we look to improve healthcare systems and healthcare outcomes for Canadians, we need to make sure it's being measured in a rigorous, transparent, comparable way so people can know what their tax dollars are delivering in terms of improvements to our healthcare system. It also is about modernizing the system, getting rid of fax machines, making sure that people have access to healthcare data, and that their specialists or their pharmacists have access to the right information to make sure people get the best quality of care. A huge cornerstone of these agreements that we're signing with the provinces are around better, rigorous data collection, so that Canadians can know right across the country that they are getting the very best quality of care necessary, and that improvements that are brought in one part of the country can be modeled and taken on in other parts of the country. This is how we create a stronger system. Of course, we recognize that right across the country, there are different priorities, different challenges, which is why we're negotiating these agreements directly with the provinces in terms of their priorities. But even within provinces, we know there are different needs in different regions. Particulièrement ici dans le nord de l'Ontario, où les accès aux soins de santé sont plus difficiles que dans le reste de l'Ontario, on a besoin d'amener des mesures spécifiques. That's why we're leaning in specifically on a number of initiatives for Northern Ontario that will make a huge difference. In terms of the Northern Ontario School of Medicine, we're announcing 30 more undergraduate spots and 41 more postgraduate spots to ensure that there are the healthcare workers and indeed the primary care physicians here in the north, trained in the north, that are going to be able to serve northwestern Ontario and the remote and rural areas that are part of this and are often underserved. We're also going to be increasing cancer screening through mobile units across northern Ontario, because we know that's a very real need that has been identified for remote and northern communities. We're also moving forward on better training on anti-Indigenous racism to make sure that every healthcare center is more welcoming and more sensitive and culturally appropriate to the needs of Indigenous peoples. We're moving forward on more primary health teams across underserved areas in the north. Et bien sûr, ça fait partie de notre engagement d'assurer plus de médecins et de professionnels de la santé qui parlent français, qui peuvent desservir la communauté francophone ici dans le nord de l'Ontario. Ça fait partie de nos engagements à travers le pays, mais c'est particulièrement pertinent ici dans le nord de l'Ontario. Donc, on est ici pour travailler avec les communautés, avec les experts locaux sur le besoin auquel les gens font face ici. Ça fait partie des investissements qu'on est en train de faire pour mieux soutenir les Canadiens pendant ces moments difficiles. We know we just announced pharmacare legislation yesterday that is going to move forward on ensuring Canadians can have access to medications at even better prices, particularly when it comes to family planning and contraception, but also when it comes to life-saving diabetes medication. We know that these are things that delivering for Canadians will take some of the pressures off in the very difficult and challenging economic times families are living through. On top of that, our reduction of childcare fees by 50% on our way to $10 a day has made a huge difference in families with young families with young kids. In terms of our moving forward on dental care, we know seniors 70 and up are now registering for the Canada Dental Care Benefit, which is going to start delivering in May and is making a huge difference, not just for seniors, but also will make a huge difference for the half a million young people who have accessed dental care last year because of our early moves on Canada Dental Care. We're going to continue to be there in ways that are delivering for people here in Northern Ontario and indeed right across the country, because we know being there to support Canadians, invest in the future, and prepare for the jobs, growth, and opportunities of the future is what Canadians expect of their government. We're going to continue to do that in partnership with friends and partners right across the country. Merci tout le monde.
Thank you, Prime Minister. I'll now take a couple of quick questions. First question goes to Global News.
Good morning, Prime Minister. Catherine with Global News. So a Global News investigation which broke today has revealed widespread allegations that child welfare companies in Ontario are targeting Indigenous youth to make more money. What is your reaction to that?
We have known for many years that child and family services across the country have not been giving what was necessary to Indigenous kids. Kids at risk across the country in Indigenous communities were typically removed from their communities, which means not just removed from the situation in which they're at risk, but it also means removing them from their culture, from their language, from their community, from their elders, from their very identity. And that has led to challenges with kids who've gone through the system that follow them their entire lives. That's why a number of years ago the federal government stepped up with Bill C-92, which was a co-developed piece of legislation with Indigenous leadership and communities across the country to ensure that Indigenous communities themselves could take on the responsibility of child and family care. A number of provinces resisted that, and indeed we were taken to court, but there was a recent court decision that said absolutely it is right for Indigenous communities working with the federal government to take back control of their kids at risk in order to build for a stronger future. So that is what we're doing. We have already transferred control of child and family services to Indigenous communities in a number of places across the country, but there is obviously more to do. And this Global News investigation is highlighting that there is an increased urgency on making sure that kids who are at risk get the support of a community and of an identity and a culture in which they can ground themselves instead of getting lost in a system that doesn't see them for everything they are.
Next question.
Hi, Alessia here from the Canadian Press. Your government laid out the first steps for pharmacare. When can we expect a full universal pharmacare program in Canada?
Yesterday we announced that we're moving forward on framework legislation for pharmacare, which is a huge step forward. But it wasn't the first step. Since 2015, we've been working to bring down drug prices across the country, and we know that making sure that no Canadians have to choose between paying for groceries or rent or paying for much-needed medications is something that we should be aiming for properly as a country. That's why we're glad to work with other parties in the House to deliver on a pharmacare framework and move forward specifically in two areas. Obviously, there'll be a need to have significant conversations with the provinces, but moving forward on better support for family planning and contraceptives and making sure that those are covered by pharmacare is something that will make a huge difference in the lives of Canadians from coast to coast to coast. also moving forward on a diabetes medication, making sure that people are staying healthy and preventing the slide into worse health outcomes that so often happens when people can't access affordable diabetes medication. This is something that we're glad to move forward on, and we will continue to work towards making sure that all Canadians can afford all the medications that are necessary.
Next question.
Bonjour, bienvenue Sengar, Radio-Canada. Une question de nos collègues du National. Plusieurs personnes ont dit depuis la mort de M. Mulroney qu'il était un père politique pour eux. Même s'il était conservateur, avez-vous l'impression que Brian Mulroney est davantage un père politique pour le Parti libéral aujourd'hui que pour les conservateurs actuels?
Je pense que...
J'aimerais une réponse dans les deux.
Oui. Je pense que tout le monde a leur propre souvenir de l'impact de M. Mulroney, ceux qui ont travaillé avec lui, que ce soit dans le même parti ou que ce soit dans un autre parti. La réalité, c'est que c'était un homme d'État qui se dévouait au Canada et qui mettait tout d'abord ce service envers son pays avant la partisanerie. C'était un partisan aguerri, un excellent politicien, mais il y avait toujours un respect pour le rôle et pour les responsabilités qu'il avait et un respect pour ceux qui servaient, même si c'était dans différents partis. C'est un rappel que la politique peut et doit être ancrée dans du service et du respect. On va toujours avoir des désaccords. C'est important pour notre système qu'il y ait des contrastes d'idées et de points de vue, mais de garder ce respect et de ne pas tomber dans des attaques personnelles. Je pense que c'est un rappel qui nous bénéficie tous, à tous, dans ces moments un peu plus divisifs de la politique. I think Canadians are reflecting on what an extraordinary statesman Prime Minister Mulroney was. There are certainly things that people disagreed with from one party to the next. But the idea of service and devotion to country ran through everything he did. And I think in this time of a level of toxicity and personal attacks in politics that seems to have gotten worse over the past while, I think it's important to inspire ourselves and to take a moment to remember that everyone who serves does so out of a deep and abiding love for Canada and a modicum of respect and willingness to look for common ground is something that matters not just in politics, but it matters more than ever right across the country for all Canadians.
Next question.
Hi, Angela from CTV. CTV News reported that an employee of DND was given nearly $8 million to work on the controversial ArriveCan app. Have any other DND or federal employees been awarded?
There are investigations ongoing into what happened in the procurement process around ArriveCan. Obviously, information that has come out, and has come out over the past months, has been unacceptable. There are full-on investigations. There will be consequences for anyone who broke the rules, who broke the laws, and indeed who took advantage of a situation in which governments of all levels were doing everything they could to keep Canadians alive and safe in a never-before-seen pandemic.
Next question.
Good morning, Prime Minister. Lane Gillis of Sudbury.com. Thanks for taking our questions. I wonder how you rationalize this new agreement, because there have been critics that say there are provinces such as Ontario and Alberta that are moving toward a two-tier system, and it certainly doesn't reflect the values of a universal healthcare system that we have here in Canada. What's your take?
It is built into the agreements that we are signing, built into the $200 billion we are transferring for healthcare across the country, that respect for the Canada Health Act is tantamount. As a government, we have clawed back, pulled back money from provinces that have not abided by the rules of the Canada Health Act, and these agreements are no different. We expect public health care to be reinforced and strengthened, as unfortunately we see conservative politicians, including at the federal level, muse about two-tier health care. We know that in Canada, health care needs to be available for everyone, high quality for everyone, and accessible in a timely manner for everyone.
Thank you. Next question.
Hello, Prime Minister. Erica Corso with CBC. You mentioned off the top that yesterday we did lose former Prime Minister Brian Mulroney. What is Mulroney's environmental legacy that you can tell us about?
Well, I think one of the things that we remember is he stick-handled very well the relationship with the United States. There are always significant challenges, and even as we were moving forward, he was moving forward and signing a historic economic free trade agreement. He was also very, very firm in fighting against acid rain and fighting for a cleaner environment. He created many national parks. He contributed to the first beginnings of awareness of climate change by a government. And he has been recognized by environmental organizations as one of the greenest prime ministers Canada has ever had. It is a nice reminder that just being a conservative doesn't automatically mean that you don't care about the environment. There is a choice that the current Conservative Party is making that they would be good to reflect upon, because Brian Mulroney understood that caring for the environment, caring for the planet, caring for the people who live on it is part of building a strong economy for the future, and that is just a small part of his large legacy that we'll be reflecting on for many years to come.
Thank you, Prime Minister. That concludes our scrum.
Merci beaucoup tout le monde.